Well, I think it's fair to say that the issue of free speech is a very contested one. It's one that leads to a lot of discussion, a lot of debate, and to be honest, quite a lot of argument as well. I mean, you know, raise it with your friends or whatever, and I'm sure that there's a lot of different opinions that people have about free speech and free speech in society as a whole. And it's because of that, really, that the issue of free speech is something that's never really far away from the headlines. It's something that is constantly, I think, in the headlines and in the press. So think about what we've seen recently in Britain. The fact that the far right here are on the march. I'm sure people are aware about it, and there'll be lots of discussions over the weekend. But what we've seen recently is that a shift has taken place where the far right have built up support for Tommy Robinson. They held a rally of 15,000 people in London. And really what they're trying to do is to make a breakthrough on the scale that the far right have in European countries, in places like Germany, like Poland, and so on. What is the issue that they are mobilising around? It's about free speech, isn't it? Tommy Robinson has portrayed himself as a martyr, someone who's had his free speech taken away from him, and he has been at the figurehead of this movement and this attempt to build the far right in Britain. The question of free speech is also particularly big on university campuses, like Camilla mentioned, because there really is a narrative that says that free speech on the campuses is under attack. And it's under attack from the so-called snowflake generation. For people who aren't familiar with this term, this is the idea that there's young people and students who just ban everything that they don't like. They ban every opinion that they disagree with. They can't handle anyone disagreeing with them. And this has been ratcheted up. There's been a bit of a frenzy around the idea that free speech is under attack on campuses, so much so that the Tories have set up the Office for Students, which was initially headed up by Toby Young until he attended a far-right conference down the road, a eugenics conference down the road. But they are so worried about freedom of speech being under attack on the campuses that they've set up the Office for Students. And the job of the Office for Students is to fine universities who are clamping down on free speech and actually to monitor and to try and protect and so-called protect free speech on campuses. And this clearly fits with a wider narrative, doesn't it? And this is a narrative that you hear from the right wing, which is really that the right wing are the protectors of free speech. That free speech is a great British value that is under attack, and it's under attack from the left. From the left, who are trying to ban and no platform people. It's also attacked from Muslims who won't hear anything that criticises Islam. And there's this general narrative, isn't there, that the left are attacking free speech, but the right are the ones who are defending it. And I'm not going to surprise you by saying from the outset that I think we should reject this. I think when the supporters of Tommy Robinson talk about free speech, really they're talking about the right to insult and attack and whip up racism to anyone that they want without any kind of retribution. But clearly, though, the fact that the discussion around the issue has been ramped up to such a level means that it needs a bit of a discussion here about to try and iron out exactly what is going on. And I think our starting point really has to be that we are in favour of free speech. We want people to be able to say what they think and to have more freedom in society. The problem is, though, is that under capitalism, in the society that we live in, there are actually quite a lot of limits on free speech. Free speech is actually quite limited in society at the moment, because when we're talking about free speech, we're not just talking about the right to be able to just say something. Anyone can sit in their bedroom and say whatever they want. That's not what free speech means. The real question is who hears it, how far does it go, what is the reaction to it, and is it allowed to be said to a wider audience? And I think when you put it like that, you see that actually free speech is quite limited in society. So think about the libel laws that exist at the moment. Which really mean that if you have enough money, you can clamp down and you can prosecute people for saying stuff about you. So I know that there's comrades here from Austria I don't know if there's any in the room, but there's a delegation from Austria here at Marxism, and I know that they faced a lot of difficulties because they've labelled the leader of the FPO as the far right party. They've labelled him as a fascist, and they faced a court case about this. They've been taken to court. They faced a lot of court fees. I think they had to change their name, and so on. And actually, on a more basic level, you think about the fact that we live in a society where the media and the big media platforms are controlled by a tiny minority. They're controlled by a tiny minority of billionaires who really decide how far people's speech goes. You think about someone like Rupert Murdoch. Rupert Murdoch has a huge say in who has free speech in society, because not only does he have platforms that reach millions of people, but he also decides who speaks on these platforms. And so Tory politicians, people like Jacob Rees-Mogg, who hold very little in common with the majority of people in society, get a lot of airtime, whereas ordinary people don't have access to that kind of airtime, to that kind of sound waves, and so on. And what that means, the fact that the corporations in the press have such power, means that it's not really a level playing field for free speech, is it? Some people, the elite in society, have a platform which reaches millions of people, whereas actually everyday people like me and you do not have the same kind of platform. So when we're talking about free speech, it is a very much uneven and not a level playing field. And some people have raised the fact that the internet has changed this because everyone can now tweet, and I hope everyone's tweeting on the Marxism hashtag here today, but everyone can go on Facebook, you can gain followers, you can put out what you want, you can set out a website, and so on. And to some extent this is true, but even this we know is limited as well in terms of addressing that fundamental imbalance, isn't it? You think about the recent net neutrality regulations that have been discussed in the US, which will really say that if they are passed in their entirety, will say that actually oppositional organisations like revolutionary socialist organisations could be banned from the internet or at least face a different kind of download speed and so on. And so once we accept that we are living in a world where access to free speech and the ability to spread what you want to say is in an uneven playing field and is in balance, it's quite easy to point out that the people who benefit from this, those at the top of society, they like to pretend that they're very much in favour of free speech, don't they? This is something you constantly hear. Like I say, the Tories have set up an office for it, but the authorities are constantly banging on and the press are constantly banging on about the need to protect free speech, the need to make sure that free speech remains absolute. This is something that we're told, isn't it, that free speech is absolute, that everyone has a right to it, and so on. And you see, I think it's quite important that we point out the hypocrisy of these people. We point out how hypocritical it is. Think about someone like Trump, Donald Trump in the US. In many speeches, he's talked about the need to protect the First Amendment, which gives you freedom of speech and so on. The reality is, though, Trump also says that if you're a black American footballer who takes the knee during a national anthem, you should be sacked from your team. You shouldn't be able to express solidarity with the Black Lives Matter movement. Think about the French government. The French Revolution and the Republic, when it was first born, freedom of speech was at the heart of it. You know, this is a free republic where all citizens are equal and so on. Think about the French government's Islamophobic laws that tell Muslim women what to wear or ban Palestine protests or make it illegal to be in favour of supporting Palestine and the BDS movement. And actually, if you think about Britain at the moment, there is a concerted effort at the moment to crack down on free speech from the authorities. And really what I'm talking about here is the Prevent agenda. I'm sure people in the room have heard about it, but the Prevent agenda, with the stated aim of trying to stop radicalisation, really is forcing public sector workers in Britain to spy on mostly on students. And when they say spy on students, really they mean target Muslim students. With no hint of irony, the Prevent agenda is an effort to bring so-called British values, which apparently include free speech, to protect them. Public sector workers have to spy on students, on patients, and so on. And It is the most draconian policy you could think of, because what it means is that people with no criminal conviction, people who have had no criminal conviction or done anything wrong in the law, are referred to the authorities for fears of radicalisation. So you had the case of 16-year-old Rahman Mohammadi, who was wearing a Palestine badge at school and was referred to the police and to the prevent officers. You had the case of another student who put up a poster during Ramadan for Islamic Relief, the charity that raises money during Ramadan. He was referred to prevent. You even had the absurd case of someone being reported to prevent by their neighbour who said that their curtains were closed too often. People are probably worried that they'd let their curtains on at home and they'll be reported. But seriously, it leads to an absolute climate of fear. And it means that teachers and nurses and doctors and so on are told to look out for the most mundane things, mood swings, changes in how people dress, changes in behaviour, and so on. And one of the biggest aspects of it, my mum's a teacher and she talks about this, one of the biggest impacts of prevent is that it leads to a self-censorship. It means that people are worried to actually raise the genuine concerns they have about the world. So students, especially Muslim students, are worried to talk about what is happening in Syria, or worried to mention Palestine, or worried to even talk about their faith for fear that someone will be listening and will refer them to prevent. And I think the reason I mention this is because recently, I think it's fair to say that free speech, to be honest, has in some ways become a code word for Islamophobia. This is what Tommy Robinson and so on are talking about. They are really talking about the right to be Islamophobic with no kind of retribution. And this is something that has really developed, especially after what we've seen with the controversies over cartoons in the last few years, really cartoons that depict Islam. So you think about the Charlie Hebdo attacks that happened a couple of years ago. After those attacks took place, there was almost a narrative, wasn't there, that it was brave to criticise Islam and to be Islamophobic, and that Charlie Hebdo was a brave magazine because it was taking on totalitarian Islam. And actually, I think, I mean, a lot of my friends did it on Facebook, you know, people changing their profile picture to Je suis Charlie and so on. And the idea that what Charlie Hebdo did was brave, was free speech, and was something to be defended. Now, again, I think we have to reject this. People might have seen the recent cover of the Charlie Hebdo magazine. Marion Poujtou, who is a French student union officer in the Sorbonne, she's a Muslim woman. She gave an interview wearing the hijab, which is banned in public places in French society. She gave an interview that lasted 1 minute out of an hour-long programme. So, you know, if you'd gone to make a cup of tea, you would have missed it. She made this interview. There was uproar in France about the fact that she wore the hijab. Politicians, media spokespersons and so on, absolutely raging that she had done this. The front cover of Charlie Hebdo the next month portrayed Marion Poujtou wearing the hijab as a monkey eating a banana. The insinuation really from Charlie Hebdo is that if you're a Muslim woman who wears a veil, really you're subhuman. You're below human, you're a monkey. There is nothing brave about this. There is nothing brave about this. This is not about, you know, exposing your right to free speech. This is about absolute, outright racism and Islamophobia to one of the most oppressed groups in French society. And you see, in that example, it wasn't like it was the left who were cracking down on free speech. Actually, the left opposed what Charlie Hebdo did, and the left said that this kind of racism leads to free speech of Muslim women being taken away. It leads to attacks in the street, it leads to more racist laws, and so on. This was something that was driven by the right. The other example I want to look at is what's happened in Britain recently, really with the controversy around anti-Semitism and the Labour Party and the attacks on Jeremy Corbyn and the left as being anti-Semitic, because we have seen an orchestrated attempt by the right wing of the Labour Party, by supporters of Israel, to really label any criticism of Israel as being anti-Semitic. Now, obviously, any kind of anti-Semitism must be vigorously opposed. But what the latest smears against Corbyn and the left have done is they have created a climate of fear on those who want to speak out for Palestine and against the Israeli state. So think about the IHRA definition, which is the new definition that is being brought in, which defines anti-Semitism. What that definition says is that to label Israel as a racist state or as an apartheid state is in fact anti-Semitic. And this has led to a climate of fear. I'm sure people have been aware about it, of Labour Party members being expelled for tweeting support for Palestine, for tweeting criticism of Israel, and so on. And if you want to talk about cracking down on free speech, there is a perfect example. And again, in that example, it is the right who are cracking down on it, and it's the left who have been opposing it. And the point in all of this, really, I think, is to show that we have to reject that narrative, that somehow the left are to blame for any attacks on free speech. Actually, it's something that comes from the state, from the right, and so on. Now, obviously, like I said at the beginning, the question of free speech is a contested one, and it means that there's quite a lot of controversy around it. And a lot of that controversy, I think, has focused on the issue of no platform. The question of no platforming people in universities, in elsewhere, and so on. And really, like I said, there's a narrative that no one can speak in a university now for fear of being no platformed. This is what the Daily Mail and the Sun will say, that anyone who is, who wants to speak at universities face getting shut down, face protests, face no platform, and so on. And I think one thing we have to point out is that these reports are inaccurate because they lump everything together. They lump a protest against someone speaking with the same as a fascist being no platform. So recently at Queen Mary's, I know that the student socialist worker group there organised a protest when Jacob Rees-Mogg came to speak. Now, Rees-Mogg is against abortion rights for women. He wants to end freedom of movement for EU migrants, and generally a pretty nasty guy. I think the Swiss group there were perfectly right to organise a protest against him. I think actually protesting people whose views you find offensive and you know that are racist and sexist and so on, actually this is a genuine example of free speech. So I think it's important that we don't buy into the narrative that everyone is being no-platformed on campus. Actually, it's a bit more nuanced than that. But nevertheless, I think with the fact that the far right in Britain are on the march again, we are clearly going to face lots more discussion and debate about the question of no-platform, about is it okay to no-platform fascist and far right groups. And you see, for us, the tactic of no-platform is an incredibly important one. The idea that fascists should not be denied a platform is an important one, because what it says is that fascists are not like any other group in society. It's not like they're just like any other kind of nasty party. Fascists are actually a particular group in society that will use conventional and mainstream politics to try and gain influence, to try and get to power, and to then stifle democracy for all other groups. So they will try and get into power to stifle free speech for others. Obviously, Hitler in the 1930s is the most pressing examples of this. And it's because learning those lessons of the past, that no platform is a collective response from below that really aims to deny fascist legitimacy. It says that we should not debate, we should not provide a flat platform for fascists because they are not a legitimate party. We should keep them outside the mainstream of society. We should recognise that it's not just another political ideology, it's one that will ride over working class people, Muslims, and so on. And there's different ways you can enact the no platform strategy. A good example is what comrades were involved in Lewisham in South East London recently. Where Anne-Marie Waters, who is a big supporter of Tommy Robinson, a big-time Islamophobe, she's head of the For Britain party, a far-right party, she was due to speak at hustings in Lewisham. And so what Stand Up To Racism and others in the area did is they put pressure on the Labour Party councillor, the Labour Party candidate to pull out, which she did, and then organised a protest at the hustings, which was hundreds strong, with lots of people from the local area, and actually shut down and didn't allow Anne-Marie Waters a platform. This is a perfect example of it. And I think with the question of no platform, we do have to point out that it is different from banning someone. No platform is not saying and not calling for the state to ban people. I don't think we should support giving the state more powers to choose who can and can't do what. Because to be honest, I think they come after us. I think if the state had the power to ban extremists and so on, I think we'd be on their hit list. So no platform is not arguing for the state to ban people. It's really arguing that if fascists are given legitimacy, then Muslims, LGBT people, working class people and so on should come together to oppose that legitimacy. And I think it's an important strategy that we have to defend. But I'd be interested to see what other people think, because there is an argument, isn't there, from sort of liberal sections of the media, which is that famous saying, isn't it, that I disagree with what you say with, but I'll defend to the death your right to say it. This idea that we have to defend everyone's right to say everything and that therefore no platform stops that. And you see, I think that's a very abstract position to take. History shows that if fascists are given a platform, if you give them an inch, they'll take a yard. If you look at somewhere like France, where the far right, the Front National, there was big debates on the French left about whether they should be called fascist, about whether there should be no platformed, and so on. And there were arguments which said that if the Front National are given a platform, they'll make idiots of themselves and no one will vote for them. This is what you hear about Tommy Robinson and so on, isn't it? If he's given a platform, he'll show how stupid he is and you know, ordinary people won't vote for them. The reality is that fascists are wolves in sheep's clothing, aren't they? They don't say what their programme is. Of course, they talk and try and identify with the downtrodden and working class people. And the legacy in France, which you've seen, is that where the Front National were not opposed, where they were not no-platformed, you've seen their rise from the 1980s onwards to the fact that actually Marine Le Pen might be the next president of France. And I think it's just important to reaffirm that, because clearly this is a debate that will be taking place over the next few months here in Britain. So I also want to talk just briefly about some of the controversies that have taken place on the left and address this thing about, is the left no platforming, speakers on campus and so on. And I think a lot of it has been raised recently. Really, a lot of it has focused around the issue of transphobic feminists, feminists who say that trans women aren't women and so on. And you see, I have a lot of sympathy with trans people who want to no-platform those people. I do sympathise with them, because some of the stuff that people like Jermaine Greer say, to be honest, is horrible, it's disgusting, it's violent. However, I think it's a mistake to say that no platform is going to be used for anyone apart from fascists. I think we have to reinforce the idea that no platform is a unique policy which is only used in the fight against fascism. And this also comes into the discussions that are going on at the moment around safe spaces on campus. I'm sure that people have heard about this, but the safe spaces policy on campus is the idea that we create spaces on campus that are free from racism, from sexism and so on, and that you can't let certain people into them. And I think, obviously, like, again, I sympathise with people who do want to create this. We want to kick racism, we want to kick sexism and so on off our campuses. The problem, though, I think a little bit with safe spaces is that what it can mean is that you end up banning people, or you end up saying that some people aren't allowed to come in to certain meetings. And I think the problem with banning all offensive ideas is that, to be honest, it becomes quite very exclusive about who's allowed in political spaces. It says that to come into a political space, you have to have a fully formed ideology that is, you know, fully formed and is strong on every issue, on trans, on race, on sexism, and so on. And I think we've got to be careful about that, because I think it is exclusive. I'm not saying that we should not challenge sexism or racism. Of course we should. But the idea that people should be banned from coming into a space, I think, is the wrong route to take, because I don't think really it understands how contradictory consciousness works. Because we know that because in society, the ruling class and the media pump out the most reactionary racist, sexist ideas. Obviously, in society, some people are going to carry those ideas in their heads, aren't they? Some people are going to agree with those ideas. And actually, what we argue is that you should unite with people on what you do agree with and challenge them on the things you don't. You shouldn't just shut down any kind of debate on the issue. The way to deal with it is not to legislate, not to ban, but it's to engage with people and try and challenge them. And I think when you put this into the concrete, it becomes more obvious. So think about something that happened at the Communication Workers Union conference earlier this year, where in that conference you can have a motion going up which says solidarity with the Windrush generation, no deportations of the Windrush generation. That motion passes unanimously. Everyone in the room supports it. Later that day, you can, to the same group of people, the same delegates in the room, you can have another motion about EU migrants, about freedom of movement, which falls, which says that actually accepts the ideas that EU migrants drive down wages and are to blame for low wages and so on. So the same group of people think, oh, the immigrants that came here in the 1950s, they're good. Oh, but the ones who came here past 2000, not so sure. Now, how would you deal with these people? It's not to say that you should ban them because they're against freedom of movement. It's actually to say, look, we unite with you on the Windrush stuff. And by the way, you're wrong on EU migrants. But we shouldn't say that these people should be banned or shouldn't be allowed in to threaten a safe space and so on. And so to conclude, really, I think the issue of free speech is clearly quite a difficult one to navigate. There's going to be a lot of debates coming up in the next few months. And I think for us, it's important that we're not defensive on it. We have to be clear that the biggest threats to freedom of speech come from the right wing and that the left has nothing to apologise for. And we also have to expose those on the far right who are using the freedom of speech as a rallying cry for Islamophobia. But I think there will be difficult discussions in the time to come. I think political clarity is key on the issue. And we also have to point out that on the question of no platform, the stakes are quite high. The fact that we're starting Marxism with international comrades coming from around Europe, which is fantastic, but there's a shared experience from those international comrades, which is the rise of the far right and fascist parties from Germany, Poland, Hungary, and so on. And it's for that reason that the tactic of no platform is key, but that to navigate the debates around free speech, I think it's important we have political clarity as well. And I'll leave it there.